now, who's going to bowl to Harbhajan Singh, the new batsman. Precepts gully, a backward point and a forward short leg. Here comes Broad. He's in. He bowls to Harbhajan. Oh!
Over and out. My innings of a lifetime with Test Match Special. Written and read by Henry Blofeld.
Come in front. And goodness me, the celebrations are tremendous. Harbhajan Singh, LBW Bowl.
Preface. Why are you retiring from Test Match Special is a question I've been asked countless times since I made the original announcement. There's no simple answer to that one. There is no one reason. It is a combination of factors which, taken together, have convinced me that the day has come to wave goodbye to a job I have loved, one I've been incredibly lucky to do for nearly 50 years. I have to concede that at my age, and these words are being written when I'm less than 2 months away from my 78th birthday, commentating becomes a little harder each year. One of my eyes suffers from macular degeneration, and although the other is still in mid-season form, my sight is not quite as sharp as it was. My reflexes, too, are suffering just a touch from old age. Jumping in and out of chairs and a commentary box has always been a noisy and inexact science with me. That's not going to get any better now either. And then there are my hips. But I don't think there is any need to go down that road. The result of all this is that I do not find commentary quite as easy as I once did. And if it is more difficult, it becomes less fun. Then there is the evolutionary progress of commentary itself, which moves in step with the way the game changes. Everything happens more quickly today. The influence of first 50-over cricket and then T20 has happily caused Test cricket, still the gold standard of the game, to move along at a much more satisfactory speed, which suits the world in which we live. Day-night cricket has now begun to spread to Test matches, and the twilight zone, when floodlights take over from daylight, causes enough problems when both eyes are fully functioning. Limited over matches offer me less time to do the one thing that I am perhaps any good at, which is to describe the scene. In fact, the curtain came down on my one-day career at the end of the 2015 season in England. TMS producer Adam Mountford and I quietly agreed that I should let the limited over stuff go quietly past the off stump. Then there is the style of commentary. Over the years, it has become much more conversational. Instead of coming in at the end of the over or when a wicket falls, summarizers nowadays are involved in an ongoing conversation with the commentator. This again inevitably restricts the time I have to describe all that I can see in front of me. Try keeping Jeffrey Boycott or Michael Vaughan quiet for a couple of balls, let alone a whole over. Far from there being any harm in this, it probably makes TMS even more approachable and enjoyable for the listeners. There are some who say that, while this is true, it also leads to an increase in trivia, but we're not bad at that anyway. Finally, a vain thought. It is probably more sensible to go when people are saying nice things about you than to wait until they shriek, "Why on earth is he still there?" A little bit of all these things helped me to make up my mind. In real life, people don't often wake up, jump out of bed and shout, "I'm off!" But that's pretty well how it happened with me. It suddenly came to me one day just after the 2017 cricket season had begun. I have at least spared the BBC from having to go through the business of sacking me, or putting me out to grass, if you prefer it. With Jonathan Agnew at the helm alongside Simon Mann, Test Match Special is in the safest of hands, with plenty of relatively new commentators to back them up. Ed Smith, Alison Mitchell, Charlie Dagnall and Dan Norcross are all stout performers, with two more former England players, Ebony Rainford-Brent and Isha Guha, also ready to flex their most knowledgeable muscles. Then there are the wise old owls in the corner, led by Vic Marks and Jeffrey Boycott, with Michael Vaughan, Phil Tufnell and my stage partner, of course, Graham Swan, alongside them, to make sure the commentary guy doesn't slip up. These are the commentators and summarizers who will soon be taking TMS on to further heights. With the future in safe hands, I can now look back lovingly and laughingly at all the many mishaps and adventures I have had in and around the commentary box. Who would have thought that one of my most memorable moments on air would be describing the tropical storm to end all tropical storms? That my most loved form of transport to an overseas tour would be a 1921 Rolls Royce? That I would once get within an hour of playing in a test match? That I would survive liberal doses of tear gas at the cricket in Kingston, Jamaica, and then Lahore? that I would commentate with the Maharaja of Baroda. And on it goes. There were some great matches to describe, some hysterical scenes in various boxes. Above all, there were the tremendous friends with whom I was lucky enough to work. Some of them were household names, others became brief and for a short time equally notable companions. Then there was the gentleman who visited our box in the pavilion at Lord's and promptly lay down on the floor and went to sleep. I know we're boring. I am old enough to have worked with all the main stars in the commentary box, with three exceptions. I never even met Howard Marshall, who, before the war, pioneered the course we have all followed since. By an extraordinary chance, I touched base with his granddaughter the day I announced my retirement. I also missed commentating with Rex Alston. He had retired before I began, though there was one splendid moment in August 1987 when Rex and Jim Swanton, both old men, climbed up the stairs to the commentary box at the top of the pavilion at Lord's. It was during the centenary match between the MCC and the rest of the World 11. For a few overs, Alston and Swanton plied their old trade. Rex still had those lovely modulated tones with a hint of the schoolmaster he had been before he took to the airwaves. His precise voice was still wonderful to listen to, but his eye now missed some of the details. It was Trevor Bailey who sat beside him and lent a helping hand when it came to identification. When he had retired as a regular commentator, Rex wrote about county cricket for the Daily Telegraph. He was always good fun, and it was lovely to arrive on the first day of a match at the county ground in Hove or anywhere else in the south of England, which had become his parish, and to find him there. His presence guaranteed three amusing days. Reassuringly, Jim Swanton boomed away like the latter-day Bismarck we had grown to love, and indeed who I had encountered briefly when I first entered the box in 1972. Jim was a hard taskmaster. Even on this celebratory occasion, he pointed his finger at what he considered to be irrelevant frivolity on the air. The original plan was for these two to be joined in the commentary box by John Arlott, who had agreed to fly over from Alderney. In the end, he was unable to travel, and we had to make do with a telephone conversation when those unmistakable tones were still, well, unmistakable. Another famous commentator I never worked with, although I was lucky enough to meet him, was Charles Fortune, who was, loosely speaking, South Africa's equivalent of John Arlott. He was born in 1906 in Wiltshire and emigrated to South Africa in 1935. Fortune had a beguilingly inconsequential tone and a tendency to be lured into extravagant descriptions of the local scenery. Alan McGilvery, his Australian counterpart, whose form of commentary could hardly have been more different, wrote of Fortune, "He would lose track of the game every so often, and he didn't often worry about such minor details as the score. But the words flowed from his mouth like a cascade of flowers, colourful and sweet-smelling and rich in warmth and character," which was unusually poetic for McGilvery. Another idiosyncrasy of Fortune's was his refusal to complete the knot with his necktie. The main front bit of the tie simply hung down loose over where the knot should have been. It gave him a lopsided look. I well remember the withering and unrepeatable reply he gave to someone who, one day in Port Elizabeth, tried to put him right over this. He was a dear man and a great lover and purveyor of the English language. Like these great names, most of the people I've encountered working for Test Match Special have been memorable characters in their own right. I have tried to illustrate this by sharing with you stories about them in which I was involved or for which I had a front row seat in the stalls. Minor disputes take place in all walks of professional life, but in this regard, Test Match Special was a special place to work. In all the years I've been with the programme, there might have been the odd rumble, but this was always safely away from the box, where professionalism ruled. Any differences were soon forgotten, and the blend of commentary seldom suffered from clashing personalities. Since I announced that I was going to retire from TMS, one thing that has staggered me is all the warmth, kindness, and support I have received. It has all been hugely heartwarming, and I never expected it to happen as it has. I've been asked to appear on a great many shows, both on radio and television, from Piers Morgan and Andrew Marr down to umpteen local BBC radio stations up and down the country. I've also taken part in a number of game shows, and at Lord's I was honoured to be asked to ring the five-minute bell before the start on the Saturday of the Test match against South Africa. Nottingham City Council has even named a bus after me, which I launched, if that's the right word, at a neighbouring bus stop during the lunch interval on the first day of the Test this year against South Africa at Trent Bridge. I hope that you will enjoy the following pages almost as much as I did at the time. I hope, too, that you will be able to see what a wonderful life I have been lucky enough to have. This is a very personal book. I'm writing it without any intention of telling readers the right way or the wrong way to commentate, as if I knew. It is a chronicle of enjoyment, for I have been left with nothing but wonderful memories of the commentary box and all those I have worked with. Chapter 1. Letting the cat out of the bag. I don't think it had ever really occurred to me that one day I would have to retire from Test Match Special. Although I was 77, I was still doing five or six Test matches a year, three or four at home and a couple on tour. I was getting by, I like to think, and my inability to determine with anything approaching accuracy the name of the fielder at third man had, I hope, become more of a joke than anything else. Then, in December 2016, I went out to India to commentate for TMS on the tests in Bombay and Madras. In both matches, England lost their last five second innings wickets for 16 and were massively beaten. I would like to think my commentary was a touch shorter than England's batting, but maybe not by much. On the 20th of December, the fourth, and as it happened, the final day in Madras, I was on the air when England's batsmen seemed almost to throw their hands in. A slog drive from Moeen Ali off Ravi Jadeja had ended up in Ravi Ashwin's hands at deep mid-off. I got that right. Liam Dawson, in his first test, was now facing leg spinner Amit Mishra. We were at the bowler's end, and Mishra was running away from us. For Dawson, he had about five men round the bat, including a short mid-off and a short extra cover. He ran into bowl, his arm came over, and I saw the ball leave his hand and Dawson start to shuffle across his stumps. Then, for a moment I shall never forget, everything went blank. I could see nothing, although the crowds were cheering their heads off, which told me a wicket had fallen. When my vision cleared, I saw Dawson taking his first step towards the pavilion, and the close fielders on the offside jumping about in celebration. I took a punt, and Dawson has been caught there at short extra. Sonny Gavaskar, sitting beside me in the summariser's chair, now entered the conversation. No, Henry, he was bowled. Get out of that one. I struggled on, but it must have sounded dreadful. The memory of that moment has never left me. It was my worst experience at the microphone. An eye specialist told me later there is a logical explanation for what happened and that it was a chance in a million, which was little help. The incident played on my mind relentlessly. Then, in the middle of the night, just as the England season was beginning in April 2017, I suddenly realised the time had come. As the problem had happened to me once, it could obviously happen again, and at my age, things like that do not get better. They only get worse. I did not want to make a fool of myself, and even more important, I did not want the programme, which was responsible for the wonderful life I have led, be made to look stupid too. When I put it to my wife Valeria the next morning and asked her advice, she told me she understood, but insisted that it had to be my decision. Within an hour, I'd rung up Rafe Bruniers, my agent, and told him that I was retiring. By then, the BBC had bravely asked me to commentate on three test matches for TMS during 2017. The first and the last were at Lord's against South Africa and the West Indies. The second was against South Africa at Trent Bridge, always my favourite test match ground. I could hardly have asked for a better way to go. I also told my great friend Richard Kay, a man of repute, charm and influence at the Daily Mail. It was his paper which finally broke the story on Friday the 23rd of June. It would all have come out rather sooner if it had not been for the political shenanigans surrounding Team A, Jay Corbyn, Brexit and the accompanying general election. They had not left much room for anything else. I must admit, I was more than a touch nervous as to what the reaction would be. The night before the story broke, I spent the evening at home with Valeria. We talked about my years with TMS. I went through my memories of some of those I'd worked with over the years, their foibles, their strengths, their characteristics of the microphone, and so on. I told Valeria I was sad I'd never met Howard Marshall, the man who, before the war, had really put cricket commentary on the map. Marshall's commentary in that wonderful voice as he described Len Hutton breaking Don Bradman's test record score of 334 against Australia at the Oval in 1938 is immediately recognisable as the early version of what we do today. It lacks the modern flourishes and the laughter, but the format is there. Marshall was extremely good-looking, with a private life to match. He was much married and had one spectacular divorce. It was his private life to which Lord Reith objected, and the BBC did not go back to him after the war. Nevertheless, he was an important figure in the story of cricket commentary. I was sad that I'd never met him, and that I'd never had any contact with his family. I'd also been unable to find out anything about him as a man, apart from the impersonal Google facts. I spent a moment or two that evening thinking about what it must have been like for him, starting from scratch. He was the man who showed those of us who came later the path we should follow. Marshall was really the Christopher Columbus of cricket commentary. The problems he faced must have been considerable. The game's administrators at that time were deeply hostile, regarding this wireless intrusion as newfangled nonsense and a tiresome and unnecessary interference, and they were not prepared to give it house room. So much so that when he was at Lord's for the Australian Test in 1934, Marshall had to run to a basement flat in Lisson Grove to do his reports. He was about to start one when the little girl in the flat upstairs began her piano lesson. I went to bed on the Thursday evening, wondering if anyone would be in the least interested in my retirement. In the grand scheme of things, I was surely an irrelevance. The Friday had hardly dawned before the telephone started to ring. Ray Brunius was an early caller and asked me first up how I was doing. It is the sort of unnecessary rhetorical question which never brings the best out of me, although I know it is always asked from the best possible motives. In any case, it was far too early for me to have any idea of how I was. At my age, there was a whole inventory to be gone through. He told me there was a marvellous piece opposite the leader page in the Daily Mail. He said he had already spoken to Ben Gallup, the BBC's head of radio sport, who had been charming. Rafe was relatively new to the agent's game and had not orchestrated a retirement before. He, like me, was slightly unsure of his ground that morning. I told him I'd already had a message from Adam Mumford, the TMS producer, asking me to ring him back as soon as possible. I decided to get up first, so that I could at least face the world on a clean-shaven footing. Rafe soon arrived at my house, arms full of Daily Mails. He was sure the telephone would ring non-stop, and he wanted to be there to take charge. I found myself vaguely pondering the past, the present, and the future. Up until that moment, I'd been thinking of retirement as a sort of surreal game that was going to be played out in a few days' time. Now it dawned on me that the whistle had gone. I didn't know what I should be feeling. There was no ghastly moment of realising that I'd burned my boats forever and, oh, help! Far from it. My immediate reaction was a feeling of relief, not only that it was out in the open, but that I was also no longer going to have to justify my place in the commentary box. And, of course, although I am nearly 100, there is so much else to do. But first, I still had to commentate on 3 more test matches. I was well aware of how important it was to be somewhere near my best for these final matches, to try and go out with a bang. I could not have enjoyed my first day of official retirement more. It was incredibly hectic. Sitting at home after breakfast, I first recorded telephone interviews for the BBC, the 6 o'clock news that evening, and then the 10 o'clock news. There were lots of calls from the local BBC radio stations wanting to talk to me. Rafe took over the calls and planned times for the interviews. Various friends who'd read the news in the Daily Mail had also picked up the telephone. It was then the turn of the Daily Telegraph for a quick talk with Patrick Sawyer. He wrote a lovely piece. My next job was an interview on the telephone with ITV, and then I had the friendliest of chats with Radio Cornwall. After that, it was Radio Norfolk, rapidly followed by Radio Merseyside. They all asked me why I had decided to retire and what my best moment had been on air. That was easy, because I'd taken the last wicket at Headingley in 1981, when Bob Willis removed Ray Bright's middle stump. I was struck by the warm and friendly tones of all those who had talked to me. I'm ashamed to say that I was even beginning to feel rather important. In between fielding other calls, we had a quick bite of something to eat. Valeria had already broken the world record that morning for making cups of coffee. Her Italian inventiveness now came to the fore, as she managed to produce a salad which was both attractive and considerably more than just edible. I've never been a great lover of rabbit food, but she manages to do something quite special with it. Anyway, body and soul had been stitched together adequately enough when, soon after 3 o'clock, a taxi arrived to take us to Channel 4. We were in the inevitable queue on the embankment by Chelsea Old Church when Rafe's telephone rang. It was his office to tell him they had on the line a lady who wanted to speak to me. Miraculous to say, she was apparently a relation of Howard Marshall. Rafe handed me his telephone, and a moment later I was talking to Howard Marshall's granddaughter. I could hardly believe it. Her name was Mandy Pete. She told me that having seen the news of my retirement, she wanted to make contact because some of her grandfather's things had come to her after he had died. They included a picture of Lords, which he had painted in 1934, the year in which Hedley Verity, taking 15 for 104 on a drying pitch, had bowled England to victory over Australia. England had won by an innings and 38 runs, a result which prompted the BBC to send Howard Marshall to report on the next test at Old Trafford. Mandy Pete told me she would like to give me the picture. She had never even met me. It was unbelievably kind and an amazing coincidence, coming as it did the day after Valeria and I had talked about Howard Marshall. I promised to get in touch with her when all the fuss had died down. When Mandy and her husband John came round to see us about a month later, she presented me with this evocative picture which he had painted from the top of the Lord's Pavilion. It features the old tavern and mound stand with the famous tall chimney on the other side of St. John's Wood Road, with all the ramshackle buildings around it, as well as some of the famous grass, more or less in the foreground. Every time I look at it, I get a thrill, because it has filled in the last remaining gap in my Test Match Special story. Mandy also had a collection of photographs, several of which showed Howard Marshall at a surprisingly sleek, early-ish BBC microphone. She kindly had a number of the pictures copied for me. It was only a few days after Mandy and her husband came to see us that I discovered in one of my bookshelves a somewhat battered old book published in 1933. It was an anthology of cricket stories put together by Howard Marshall himself. He had written a fascinating introduction in which he tried to define what cricket should mean to us all and what it meant to him. Here was the first serious commentator who at that time had barely dipped his toe in the waters of any sort of cricket writing. To these important qualities of zest and enjoyment, I would add, a little diffidently perhaps, a plea for the judicious use of sentiment. The sights and sounds of the English countryside, the smell of freshly cut grass, and the distant whir of the mower, the slow rhythm of play in sunlit fields, the lengthening shadows and the cawing rooks, all these must be added to the sum of things which form the ultimate character of cricket. As the head public relations man for pigeons, seagulls, helicopters, and all the other beyond-the-boundary attractions that form part of the picture of a day's cricket, I rest my case. After that first day, the tempo quietened. I was up early the next morning to be interviewed on Radio 4's Saturday Live. I had another early start on the Sunday to help review the papers for the Andrew Marr Show. I was with two rather earnest political experts, Fraser Nelson, the editor of The Spectator, and L.A. Mayo Hagen from the Corbyn camp. I did not come into any of that. I talked about Prince Harry letting everything hang out and saying that none of the young royals wanted the top job. I said, rather pompously, I fear, that it was probably better if they kept their feelings to themselves. My principal amusement the next day was an appearance on Radio 5 Live's Tuffers and Vaughan show on the Monday evening. In my naivety, I expected them both to be there in the studio when I arrived at London's broadcasting house armed with lots of messages. I was shown into an empty studio and given a microphone. On the television screen in front of me, I saw intermittent shots of a smiling Vaughan in a studio in Manchester, while Phil Tufnell was sitting in another in Guildford. though he still managed to look as if he was bouncing into bowl, I must say. It was terrific fun, and we had several good long-range laughs. The next morning, I really was up at some ridiculous hour for Piers Morgan and Good Morning Britain. In the afternoon, I was going to help with the commentary at a game at Latimer Upper School's ground in Wood Lane to help raise money for the victims of that unbelievably awful fire at nearby Grenfell Tower, which had claimed so many lives. The stark black shell of the building stood a few hundred yards away as a painful reminder of what had happened. Lashings, a team of former international cricketers, were taking on a side from the combined houses of Lords and Commons. Two of the Lashings players, West Indian Tino Best and England's Monty Panesar, were also in the studio to talk to Morgan about the game. To start with, he asked me a few questions about my reasons for retiring, before bringing in the other two and talking about the Grenfell Tower match. Piers had just spent 5 minutes rightly laying into the government and Kensington and Chelsea Council for refusing to be represented in the discussion he had just orchestrated about the reasons for the fire and the immediate response to it on the ground. I still cannot think of any other disaster in my adult life that affected me as this had done. It does not bear thinking about what those wretched people, including many children, had gone through in their last few minutes. That empty black shell wags a not-to-be-ignored finger at all those in any way responsible for what happened. It poured down throughout our game of cricket, but both teams were happy to ignore that. The rain somehow served to underline the sheer horror of the circumstances. I am delighted to say, too, that we raised a significant amount of money. The first two test matches of the summer were late in coming because the 50-over Champions Trophy competition had been played in June. Whatever one's views of one-day cricket, surely everyone will have rejoiced that this competition saw India and Pakistan playing each other twice. It seems unlikely the two countries will be able to play each other any time soon in their own backyards. Terrorism and politics have combined to make that almost impossible. But here they were, first in the preliminary round at Edgbaston, where India cantered to victory by 124 runs, and then by a wonderful chance in the final. By that stage, Pakistan had convincingly beaten England in the semi-final in Cardiff. They were running into form at the right time. This was confirmed to the immense delight of their supporters in the final at the Oval, when they beat India by the extraordinary margin of 180 runs. It was a frustrating summer for Indian cricket. A few weeks later, their women's team reached the final of the World Cup, but having looked as if they were going to walk it, they lost to England by 9 runs in the most thrilling finish. My own one-day commentary career had ground to a halt 2 years before in an hotel suite at the Aegeus Bowl at Southampton. I can assure you that it was not because I behaved badly in the bedroom either. Opposite the pavilion, there is a Hilton Hotel, which forms part of the ground. At international matches, the hotel is requisitioned for cricketing matters. We had been given a luxurious suite as a commentary box. This contained a succulent-looking double bed, which sparked much lively banter. It also enabled toughers to recover from a late night. New Zealand beat England by 3 wickets in that match. It was the first time I had commentated with Isha Guha, who had been a considerable medium-paced bowling force in the England's women's side. In 2014, she'd become the first woman to be used by TMS as a summariser. It's a job she does well. She has a good voice and certainly knows her cricket. I remember leaving the ground that day, wondering if I was not getting too old for one day of cricket. Looking back on it, this was another stage in the process of age taking over. Maybe I needed that double bed rather more than Tuffers or Michael Vaughan, who had usurped his position in the bed by the time the day ended. Chapter 2, Ringing the Bell. The week before announcing my retirement from TMS, I was in the commentary box at Lord's for the first test match against South Africa. My impending retirement concentrated the mind in curious ways. In the few days before the game, I found myself wondering how my life would have turned out if I'd never bicycled into a bus in 1957 when I was still at Eton. If I'd looked where I was going, would I have ended up in the commentary box and enjoyed such a wonderful life? Would I have been as lucky as I have been? Perhaps playing cricket might have provided an exciting alternative. I have always doubted this, and those who suggested that it might have done are only really basing their assessment of my pre-accident cricketing abilities on one week early in August 1956, when I discovered my bat had a middle as well as an edge. These are all unanswerable questions. It must have taken me a long time to throw off the effects of the nasty head injuries I suffered. I have been told that brain bruising takes about 10 years to work its way out. My head took the brunt of that bus, and I don't think I ever understood the full extent of my injuries. I was only 17, and when I came out of hospital and started to live life again, all I wanted to do was to get on with it. I realise, looking back now, that I was under a considerable handicap, but it only occurred to me then in a few isolated instances. My first nasty shock was quick in coming. I was desperate to go back to Eton for the last few days of my last half, as a term was called. As captain of the cricket 11, I had been quite a toff, and I wanted to play a part in all the activities that leaving boys get up to in those last few days. My house had got through to the semi-finals of the house cricket competition, and I was determined to play. The doctors were happy that, within reason, I should do whatever I felt I could do. The match took place on Agar's Plough. My house, Mr. Forrest's, were playing against Mr. Wax's boys. The captain of their side was someone I'd first met when I was 10 or 11 and who remained one of my greatest friends. Edward Scott and I had played boys' cricket in West Norfolk. Edward was a fast bowler and told me later that having to bowl at me as I was then in that house match had made him more nervous than me. He was worried about hurting me. At the time, I goaded him, saying I could cope with anything he could produce at his gentle medium pace. When we batted, I managed to see the ball, and I was able to defend well enough, but I'd always been a bit of a dasher. I now found it much harder to play my strokes. I got a few, and had hung around for a while when Edward brought himself on to bowl. I had no fear of any sort as he ran in, and I think I survived his first over without too much difficulty. Then, two or three overs later, it happened. I saw the ball was short, there was nothing wrong with my eyes, and I wanted to hook. I loved to play the hook, and it was a stroke which had brought me many runs. I'd always been quick-footed, but now I found my feet were stuck in cement. I could not move them even an inch. The signal from my brain to my legs did not get through. I was left waving my bat helplessly, and I suppose I was lucky the ball did not hit me. Edward came down the wicket, apologising profusely for bowling me a short one. I told him not to worry, but it was a dreadful moment. I had to face up to it that I was no longer the person who had bicycled into that bus. The irony was that we were playing the game not much more than 100 yards from where I had had the accident in the Datchet Lane. The miracle was that I was playing at all, but even after that ball I was still reluctant to see it like that. To start with, I was confident that my reflexes would pull themselves together soon enough. In August, I played some minor county matches for Norfolk, which I should never have done, but I was so determined to show that all was well. Of course, I hardly got a run, but that did not stop me from trying. By then, I knew I was going up to Cambridge that October. As the start of term approached, it began to occur to me that I was going into a new world where most of my fellow undergraduates would have done national service. That would give them a 2-year advantage. When you're 18, the difference between 18 and 20 seems more than just 2 years. Another handicap was that I was in the middle of the unnerving process of learning that the only thing I'd ever been any good at, cricket, was no longer working for me. But I did not grasp that in such clear-cut terms. I soldiered on blithely with a vague belief that all would be well in the end. After all, the Cambridge cricket season didn't begin until the following April, which was still a long way off. There was time for things to change. Or so my muddled thinking had it. No one was anxious to put me right either, because they did not want to dent my confidence. My life moved along, therefore, in a cheerful fog. When the spring arrived, I found in the nets at Fenner's, the Cambridge University cricket ground, that while it was not as bad as it might have been, it was a great deal worse than it had once been. I opened the batting in a few games for the university without much success. In my first innings in first-class cricket, I popped a short one in a gentle loop to forward short leg. The memory of that stroke haunts me now as acutely as it did then. Before the blasted bus, I would have hooked it for four, or so my thinking went. It was actually my wiki-keeping that was affected most. My reflexes were behaving like idiots, which made me look like one too. My total lack of success in that year's exams also pointed at the bus. When I returned to King's College for my second year that autumn, the senior tutor showed me some of the things I had written down in my exams. I could not believe it. A great deal of it was gibberish. There is no other word for it. As it had been only a college exam rather than a university exam, they took a deep breath and had me back for another year. Now, 6 decades later, my footsteps took me once again to the Test Mat Special commentary box at Lord's. For a few years, I'd been growing a little nervous as Test matches approached. I was finding the job harder, and I was not altogether sure the box still felt like home. Now that I'd told the world I was heading off into the sunset, I could hardly have felt more relaxed, and everyone was delightful, from the gatekeepers on the east gate and the stewards by the lift up to the media centre, to the girl who poured my coffee and gave me too much milk, and everyone in the box. It was a sort of antepenultimate homecoming, and I loved every moment of it. Of course, sentiment relentlessly pursued me. For a moment, I was back in 1948, sitting on the family rug in front of Q Stand, now the Allen Stand, eating strawberries. I actually touched the ball after Don Bradman had pulled it for 4. 7 years later, I was traipsing off the ground, mystified by the thunderous applause, bowled first ball in my first Eton Harrow match, only to discover a few minutes later I'd been the third victim of a hat-trick. A minute or two, but really a year later, I was leaving the ground raising a tentative and rather shy bat, having slogged 104 not out for the public schools against the combined services. As I walked up the steps into the pavilion, an elderly member shook my hand and told me it was the 100th he had seen at Lord's. I was rather bewildered and did not exactly sparkle in reply. 3 years later, in 1959, I was back at Lord's again, having scraped into a pretty average Cambridge side, the 11th choice, I think, as the exceedingly average post-bus accident opening batsman I had become. We were taking on the MCC, and Dennis Compton was playing for them in one of his last first-class games. He made 71 extraordinary runs in an innings which was unrivaled for sheer imaginative improvisation and beauty. I only once saw this innings equaled, when I kept wicket for the Arabs, a touring side formed by Jim Swanton, behind Everton Weeks on a drying pitch after a violent storm at Kensington Oval in Barbados, when the ball did everything but talk. In cricketing terms, both Compton and Weeks were by then old men. If they were still that good, what they were like in their prime, goodness only knows. In Cambridge's second innings, I managed to score my only first-class 100, and I hope I can take the moment when Dennis Compton came up and congratulated me into however many worlds lie ahead of us. Then, of necessity, we come briefly, but perhaps not briefly enough, to my only university match, when I made 2-1 and Oxford came first. That, suitably, was my last playing appearance at Lord's. As I now looked out over the ground, my mind could see once again the coaches standing in front of the old tavern for the Eton Harrow match, when, in 1955, there must have been at least 10,000 people in the ground. I thought back, too, to my first match at Lord's for TMS, a one-day international between England and Australia in 1972. We sat in the original TMS box at the back of the Warner stand, looking over the head of third man, a worrying angle. This was the first ever official one-day series. I remember, too, taking my first wife, when we were engaged, to Lord's to watch England play South Africa in 1960. As we arrived at our seats in the grandstand, she noticed a small diamond had fallen out of her engagement ring. We were on our way back to the jeweller's before the end of the first over. Brian Statham, whom I'd faced at Fenner's 2 years earlier in a stand with my first Cambridge captain, Ted Dexter, took 6 wickets that day. I saw none of them. As you can see, this first Test match against South Africa at the beginning of July 2017 was a moment when memories and ghosts ganged up on me from all directions. It made me realise how incredibly lucky I had been, and I enjoyed doing the commentary enormously. I took Joe Root to his 100. 12 months earlier, I'd taken him to 200 at Old Trafford against Pakistan. My greatest thrill came when I was asked by the MCC to ring the bell before the start of play on the third day, the Saturday. This is a privilege given to former Test cricketers and very few others. The bell has to be rung with great precision at 10:55, exactly 5 minutes before the start. Aggers knew I was going to be asked before anyone had told me. He had spent the first day exhorting me to save my most outlandish clothes for the Saturday. I always like to be colourful for Test matches. I blame my wife, who, being Italian and having spent years in the fashion world, has an eye for these things. When the day arrived, my shoes and linen trousers were yellow, my shirt orange, with a green jacket and a spotted yellow bow tie. Adam Mountford had planned that I should go out to the middle at the start of the programme. I would be chatting with Aggers about ringing the bell and my memories of Lords. Michael Vaughan, Vic Marks and Ed Smith came and went, all making their inimitable contributions, and as always, we were shepherded by Henry Moran, Adam Mountford's assistant. After 15 minutes, I was collected by someone from the MCC. I followed him up the main pavilion steps. The members gave me a lovely round of applause. I was then led along the back of the seats to the steps leading up to the balcony of what is now known as the bowler's bar, but which used to be the professionals' changing rooms. The bell hung beguilingly down from the balcony rails. We were joined by the secretary and chief executive of the MCC, Derek Brewer, who is also soon retiring. He was the master of ceremonies and took me through the drill. At 5 to 11, an MCC chap with a clock set to Greenwich Mean Time would say go. There was a reassuring authority about his grey hair. By then, I would be gripping the short rope which hung down from the bell, ready to swing it when the moment arrived. Vaughan was my chief coach and had persuaded me that I had to give it a real biff. He also suggested that as it was the five-minute bell, I should go on for 5 minutes. Derek Brewer cautioned me against this, telling me that no less a man than former umpire Dickie Bird had got it into his mind that this was the way to go forward. One hell of a cacophony was the result, until restraining hands won the day. There were now masses of MCC members standing all around me and looking up from below. When the ground announcer told the assembled multitude that I was about to ring the bell, I received another round of applause, which, although lovely, was slightly embarrassing, as, after all, I was only ringing a bell. By now, Aggers and Vaughan were on the grass just in front of us, describing events for our listeners. The clock chap just behind me was now clearly under starter's orders. I was gripping the rope tightly with both hands. Vaughan had recommended the two-handed interlocking grip. I was ready for blast-off. The clock chap gave me an authoritative go, and off I went. I gave it everything, and the interlocking grip did not let me down. There was no holding me. After six massive swings of the rope and six thunderous rings, some neighbouring hands went up to protect their ears, while others shot forward to hold me in check. Now that the bell had been well and truly rung, I was escorted up to the committee dining room. I was interviewed in front of a camera by one of the MCC staff, and I talked about my principal memories of Lords. Then I was escorted under the grandstand back to the media centre and our commentary box. What a splendid adventure it had been. England beat South Africa in 4 days by 211 runs. It was a great triumph for Joe Root in his first test as England's captain. He had made 190 in England's first innings, and it seemed an auspicious start. This test was going to be the last time I would commentate for the BBC with Simon Mann, who has become such an outstanding and reliable commentator and a good friend. He bade me farewell in glowing terms in his last commentary spell before Geoffrey Boycott wisely changed the subject. This test match had been going on alongside Wimbledon, and it was a busy time for the Mann family. One of the Wimbledon ball girls, mostly on the centre court, was Simon's 15-year-old daughter, Isabel. On her own initiative, she had applied for the job and been through 6 months of endless training sessions, during which many were sent packing. She passed all tests with high marks. Now she was fielding the balls, I dare say with greater athleticism than our father had ever been able to muster, for Roger Federer, Novak Djokovic, Andy Murray, and the rest. She was loving it and doing the job brilliantly. I talked about this briefly on air, and Simon later reminded me that I had announced her birth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.